Over to you, Rabbi.
Thank you. Hello and welcome. Shalom, everybody. It is a pleasure to see your faces and thank you for joining us. This is a very special program that we are offering, as so many of us have been following the news and unfortunately following the recent events and the difficult times that the Jewish people and the state of Israel is experiencing. We are looking for a way of contextualizing our experiences, for articulating the pain, the longing, the loss that so many of us are feeling and still trying to even articulate. Who better to be able to put our emotions and feelings to words than Rachel Korazim? Rachel, a returning lecturer to the Shah, both physically as well as online programming. Rachel is no stranger. This is the first class that you've taken with her. She is a Jewish educator, developing curriculum for Israel studies, for Holocaust studies. She teaches Israeli society through literature, through poems, stories, songs. And she invites people to engage with Israel in innovative ways. Without any further ado, it's my pleasure to hand over to Rachel.
Thank you very much, Rabbi, and shalom, and welcome everybody. Some of the names and faces are familiar, and other new friends to meet. Wonderful, and welcome to all of you. A couple of words of introduction. I don't want to take away from the time we want for the poetry by telling you stories about myself. My bio is available to the share, and it's available online, and I'm 78 in my next birthday, so it's long. We don't want to waste time over that, with one exception. Of the almost 78 years that I have been circling the sun, 3.5 were spent in Montreal. Back in the 80s, I was shlicha for the Jewish Agency and a frequent visitor to the Shaar as well as other synagogues in the city, working for the Zionist Federation, etc. Montreal was my gate to Jewish life outside of Israel. Like good old Israeli, I was a classical product of the Israeli education system, meaning I knew nothing about the Jewish life outside of Israel. But it was through my 3.5 years in Montreal that I got connected to this amazing world and never left it since. I did come back to Israel, but never went back to work for the Israeli education system, remained in all sorts of different organizations working for Jewish education worldwide. So this is time again of Hakarat HaTov, and I'm always appreciative of those 3.5 years that had changed the course of my life and my children. I am an Israeli family who has two kids who are graduates of Bialik Montreal. Not many Israeli families can say that. I can. So now into our topic. Yes, as the rabbi had said, I teach about Israel through poetry. And since the beginning of COVID, which is almost 4 years ago, I started teaching online Israeli poetry. Long story, if you are interested, all you have to know is my last name, Korazim, korazim.com. And you can go to my website and see, hang on, close to 600 recorded sessions that we have done since March 15th. I would love to tell you more about that, but not today. When we were living through the high holidays before Sukkot, before October 7th, I was already ready with my next semester of classes to start after the Chagim. And I had planned it as I always do, and I had the material and the PowerPoints and the references and this and that and the other, and in some cases the poets. And then October 7th came. And for 1 week, not more, but for 1 week, one meeting, I suggested to my participants, I think, Gloria, you might be the only one that had attended in the class right now, when we said, why don't we stick to the program as we have planned it? Anyway, we are all glued to the screens, and this would be a nice break off, and why don't we, etc. And I taught that one class, just one, and it felt so wrong. It felt so not right in the weight of October 7th. And at that time already, a week into our new phase of being, which is a new phase of being for Jews worldwide, but more so in Israel, I have realized that there is literally a tsunami of writing. Poetry, prose, new prayers, art, graphic art. And I started collecting, and I have help with translating into English, and I started teaching. And the first time we called it Poems for Our Days. And then the second time I had to call it Poems for Our Days number two. And before the semester was over, we have had 11 such sessions, all different, with all different poetry. And when we took off for the semester break that we are on right now, we had two sessions of consultation with participants. There is an average of 120 participants in every session every week worldwide, but mainly North America, and asked them if they wanted to continue this way or another. And they said they wanted to continue this way. So I'm in the midst of preparing the next semester, and the poetry keeps pouring. From that amazing richness for our 1 hour session today. Is it 1 hour or can I have a little bit more, Mark? Just 1 hour?
Go for it. Take a little bit more.
Okay, that's good. I have made my choice, but this is my choice. And then I will tell you how you can have access to more of that if you are interested. Okay, but let us start with what we have today. So we will start with my PowerPoint as always. And here we go. So as you can see, I am calling it Poems for These Days, as we are having just the one session. Here are the names of the poems I'm hoping to look at today. Homefront Command, New Regulations for Small Talk. Obviously, I will explain everything. Kaddish by Asaf Gur. Illusion by Michael Michael Zatz. Be'eri by Adib Lechman Sofer. A Good Day by Tal Shavit. Mom is Always Right by Itai Lev. Let me also show you the pictures of our poets. And a word about that. First of all, I will not be rushing. I cannot commit to be able to do all six poems. It will depend on the dynamics of our class, on your willingness to share your thoughts, your comments, your questions. However, we will try to do all six of them, and then I have reserved a surprise special for Montreal for you at the end. So we will see. One of the things that hit me very, very strongly when I started to do the collection of poems for these types of sessions, and what did I know? Like, what did I know the first day of what will come? I still don't know. As in the morning, as I turn on my computer and I start looking on Facebook and other places where these poems are published, I have no idea what will hit me today and tomorrow. So the first thing, however, was obvious that if in my past of teaching about Israel through its literature, I, of course, taught, you know, quote unquote, classics. Needless to say, Bialik and Chernichovsky, but more modern ones like Alterman and Shlonsky, and more modern, Lalea Goldberg, and so on and so forth. But a fair number of my poets, mine, the ones I chose to teach, were already gone. And a few of those who are still with us, Yibadlu L'Chayim Arukim, are pretty famous people. It's difficult to get them. But here, with this abundance of new poetry, just look at the faces. These are all young people. And I could talk to all of them. They are all on the social media. And I had correspondence and then phone calls and then Zoom calls. And it's sort of, I feel like I know all of them. They have become my friends and our friends in classes where I am fortunate enough to have one or two of them in every single class. In spite of the order of poems as I have published them on my screen, we are going to start with Michael Zatz. First of all, I love Michael. He is a young man, as you could see on the picture. He is not a poet by like his main trade or main occupation. Michael works for a large organization in Israel in which he has a relatively high level administrative position. This is an organization that deals with people on the autistic spectrum, ALUT. And his night job, if you wish, is poetry. If you are a Hebrew speaker, Michael is on Facebook. You can join him there or even in a poetry WhatsApp group, but it's only in Hebrew. And Michael is the first one who hit me maybe 2 or 3 days into the war when we were all still in shock. We all still are in shock, but it was more intense the early days. So let me read the first poem and we'll talk a little bit about it. It's very short, like you know, these poems of the Japanese tradition that people call haiku. Haiku. Achizat einayim. Madhim ech hakol nir'a zehe gam kshe'klum lo nishar oto davar. Illusion. Amazing how everything looks unchanged even when nothing remained the same. Let us go slowly with this because some of you may ask, is this really a poem? It's just a statement, but go slow. First of all, the title. The two people who are helpful with the translations, Michael Bonin was from Boston and Heather Silverman from Palo Alto. We debated how to translate the title. They have decided finally on the word illusion, and I wasn't too happy because the Hebrew achizat enayim suggests a little bit beyond illusion. It suggests maybe, you know, like something that is a little bit treacherous, like a magician, like misleading, but they promise you that you call magician, illusion artist, etc. So we'll let it be. So Michael is getting up in the morning or coming home from work, or as this might be the case, he often likes to walk with his dog. The picture is of Modi'in, his hometown, halfway between Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. And he looks around and honest to God, he cannot believe it. Everything looks unchanged, yet nothing remained the same. And this is my invitation to you into our session today. Should you speak to Israelis, should you travel there, as some people do, you may have the impression walking the streets of Tel Aviv or Jerusalem or elsewhere that everything looks the same. Trust me, it isn't. Everything had changed. And I want to draw a line from Michael's words here to connect to individual experiences that you and other people might have had even without living in Israel right now. And that is the experience when you lose somebody very close to you, a parent or a spouse, or God forbid, a child. And you get up after the Shiva and you set out of your door, and the world looks the same, and you don't get it. How can the sun rise and the rain drop when your mother is not there, or when your beloved is not there? And I think Michael, in his poem, is catching that. I don't get it. My world was totally destroyed. It's not there anymore, what I used to know, to love, to appreciate, to trust. And it's not there anymore. My words of invitation to you start with that. If many of you are connected to Israel, have homes to in Israel, visit Israel, or often live in Israel, you will have to realize that Israel is different. There is a deep sadness. There is loss of a sense of security. There is fear in the air. Lots of stuff. And one of the things most seriously hit is our language. We are very careful with the way we speak. And the next poem that I want to share with you speaks exactly to that. So let me take you there. And I think that it will give you that feeling. So I'm going to read the Hebrew first, as I always do, but I want to start with the title in English by Lital Kaplan. Homefront commands new regulation for small talk. It's hard for me to make sure that you indeed get the irony in the title. These days in Israel, from October 7th, our life is commanded by Homefront command. We are told if we are allowed to gather or not allowed to gather. We are told if our kids can go to school or not go to school, what to do when the sirens sound, what to do when there is a missile attack. Everything is where you can drive or where you cannot. Can you stay at home or not stay at home or be evacuated? Everything is by regulations of the Homefront command. And here Lital Kaplan says, yeah, but there is other stuff that now needs to be regulated in a different way. The title is ironical, it's tongue in cheek, but it's so true. So I'm reading the Ivrit to you. Hanchayot Pikud HaOref HaChadashot LeSichot Chulin, Lital Kaplan. Ma Nishma Butal? ובמקומו נשאל, מה נשמט? מה נשבר? מה נשאר? מה קורה נאסר ובמקומו נתהה? מה קורס? מה נקבר? ובמקום מה שלומך החצוף נקדיר פנים מול חברנו ונשאל, מה מלחמתך? ובמקום התשובה השגורה בשגרה עליה הוטל וטו חמור שבחמורים, אצלי הכל בסדר, יש להשיב הכל בסדק, והמקפידים בדברי אמת יענו הכל בשבר, הכל בשבר. Homefront command new regulations for small talk by Lital Kaplan. WhatsApp cancelled. Instead use what's shaken up, what's beaten up, what's blown up. What's going on banned. Alternatives? What's breaking down? What's forever gone? Instead of the rude, how are you? We must frown in the face of our friend and ask, how were you? And instead of the standard response forbidden by strict veto power, I'm fine, in fact, it is required to say everything is cracked, and the truthful ones will answer, everything is shattered, everything is shattered. You may know, if you have studied with me in the past, how I often give a moment to what I call lost in translation. And in this case, I will lead you to the places of lost in translation because I think they are important. So just bear with me. Let's look at the first verse. The English says WhatsApp was canceled, and instead there are instructions of what to use in English. I want to take you to the Ivrit. It's not an Ulpan class, but still. How do you say in Hebrew WhatsApp? You say manishma, like what can be heard. That's the literal translation. And look at what Lital, the poet, is doing. She is working with the sound, but breaking apart the meaning. So manishma, or sometimes we even used to say in slang like manish for short, what's up? And she says now the alternative should be ma nishmat, ma nishbar, ma nishar. The sound nish is there. Instead of a rhyme at the end of the line, we have a rhyme in the middle of the rhyme, and it keeps repeating that sound that will now not be completed with the same word. Instead of what's up, manishmat, what fell down, what's shaken, manishbar, what's beaten up, broken, manishar, what's blown up, what's this. The same as we continue, makore, like what's going on? And the answer again is playing on the sound, makores instead of kore, manikbar, what's breaking down, what's forever gone. And now we come to the middle of the poem where I think it's the most important, and luckily, with a stroke of genius, was a beautiful translation. The classical question in Hebrew about how are you is mashlomcha. And here I want to step out of my PowerPoint and do a little bit of drash on that. When in Hebrew you ask another person, how are you, mashlomcha or mashlomich, you are actually asking a three-layered question. The literal translation of mashlomcha or mashlomich, female or masculine, is how is your peace? Is there peace to you? How is your peace doing? Shalom. But the same root is also shalem, whole, complete. So when you ask somebody mashlomcha, mashlomich, you ask, are you whole? Are you together? Is everything together? And then the third layer of meaning is the acquired meaning of the word. How are you doing? How is your welfare? How well are you doing? So this is an expression that one is totally impossible to use these days. We have no peace. We are not whole. And for sure, we have no well-being. So what are we to do? Let's go back to the poem and then I will step up out again to show you something additional on that. So instead of the rude, how are you? Do you understand? It now became rude to ask somebody, how are you? Like, how is your peace? How is your wholeness? How is your well-being? It's rude now to assume that somebody will even have any of that. So instead of a smile, you must frown in the face of your friend and ask, how were you? Instead of how are you, mashlomcha, your peace, how were you, the Hebrew, ma milchamtecha. I want to step out again and share with you something a little bit more complex. Lital Kaplan is a young person, you could see the picture. But she is going back here poetically to a pretty well-known Israeli poem that deals with the answer to the question, how are you? Written by a poet who is not with us since 1987. So it's quite a while. And the poet was Zelda, a very famous Orthodox Hasidic woman, an amazing poet. At Pardes, we are studying her poetry. So Maxine was participating in a lesson where we took the whole poem apart to pieces. But when Zelda, at the beginning of the poem, which is called Shlomi, as if answering the person who had asked her, Mashlomich, she said, Shlomi. And the first line goes, Shlomi kashur bechut leshlomcha. My shalom, Shlomi, my well-being, is tied with a thread to yours. It's a love poem to a beloved person who probably woke up in the morning and said, Zelda, Mashlubich, how are you today? And she answered, her beloved one, his name was Chaim. She answers, my well-being is connected by a thread to yours. That line, Shlomi kashur b'chut l'shlomcha, has become nowadays a slogan in Israel. And we use it if somebody asks, I, for example, if asked Mashlomich, I will say, Shlomi kashur b'chut l'shlomam. My well-being is connected by a thread to their well-being, namely the hostages. I cannot sleep as long as I know what is happening to them. That's my, anybody asking Mashlomech, this is what I answer. Shlomi kashur b'chut l'shlomam. Yossi, my husband, is using a line from another poet, from Chaim Guri, who once asked, Mashlomcha Chaim? And he answered, Shlomi kishlom ami. I'm as well as my people. So Lital Kaplan is not wrong by presenting in her poem the suggestion that among all the other things that were broken, that we have lost, that look the same but are totally changed, is our language. We do not speak as we used to speak anymore. We watch our language. We look at somebody like, I don't know, Rabbi Fishman from Jerusalem, from the Gush. Do I know how many funerals you have attended in recent weeks? I assume quite a few. Neighbors, friends, family, we are so cautious with the way we talk to people these days. Have you lost somebody? Do you know somebody who lost somebody? Hostages maybe, wounded maybe, life totally changed, etc. So let me stop for a minute here and ask if there are any comments about the first or mainly the second, a poem, and I can put it back on the screen if you want me to for a minute. And I'm just watching if any of you is raising their hand. But let me put the poem back on the screen for you to look at, and then I will give you a chance to react to it if you want. So it's here for a few seconds for you to see. And let me check with you before we continue if anybody would like to comment or to ask. Yes, go ahead, Roma.
I don't want to comment. I just want to say how much I'm enjoying it. I'm from Israel and I speak Hebrew, so I can fully appreciate your interpretation. And I just wanted to thank you very much for being here.
Okay. Thank you.
Because it would not have come, no, probably if I would have read the poem in Hebrew somewhat, but your interpretation really widens this significance and how important it is in Israel and what's happening in Israel, because my friends and my family do not write much. They really do not write very much.
Thank you, Roma, for that. Anybody more directly to the poem? All right, let's continue and see as we go. So this one, the one I opted to start with, I think for very obvious reasons, to illustrate to you what Michael Zatz was saying in the first poem. Everything may look the same, but it's not. And we come now to Kaddish, and I should add another D to the title, and I'm sorry about the typo, and a couple of words of introduction. So a word about Asaf Gur. Oftentimes when we teach or study poetry, we are asking ourselves, who exactly is this poet, and what's his background, and what's his point of view, where is he coming from? So in this particular poem, the poet is actually in the poem, And when we get to it, I will show it to you. I want you to see that this is one of the many poems that Heather Silverman, Michael Bonin, and myself are translating as we go. Next to a poetry and literature that is being written, there is also a lot of new graphic art that is being published. And Zoya Chelansky, a Nadi from for the former Soviet Union who came to Israel many years ago already, is one of the artists who is doing an amazing artistic conversation with themes of October 7th, people hiding in quote unquote the safe rooms that turned out not being so safe, and in artistic conversation with Picasso's Guernica in the colors and the shapes. When we come to Kaddish by Asaf Gur, I'm asking yourself to brace yourself, because at times of major disaster, one of the things we will have in Jewish poetry from times immemorial is a conversation with God, an anger at God for allowing such stuff to happen. So let me read to you the Ivrit, then we'll go to discuss the English. Yitgadal v'yitkadash meirabah ve'af echad lo ba. כמה אלפים קראו לו בשבת בבוקר וזעקו את שמו והתחננו בדמעות שרק יבוא, אבל הוא שבת מכל מלאכתו. שום אלוהים לא הגיע ושום אלוהים לא ירגיע, ורק השטן חגג בלי הפרעה, מפזז בין הקיבוצים למסיבת טבח. וכתבנו מוסיף ומדווח בין לבין גם מתייפח. שיש תינוק שרוף, ויש תינוק חטוף, ויש תינוק יתום, ויש תינוק בן יום, מוטל מחובר בחבל הטבור לגופת אמו, ולא הספיק אפילו לגלות מה שמו. מה יירשם על המצבה הקטנטנה, עם תאריך אחד ללידה ולפטירה? This poem is on two slides, but let's do them one by one. יתגדל ויתקדש מי רבה, and no one came. Many thousands called him on Shabbat morning, crying his name out loud, begging him with tears just to come. But he sees from all his work, no God came and no God calmed, and only Satan celebrated uninterrupted dancing between kibbutzim and the slaughter festival. And our correspondent goes on to report, all the while sobbing, saying there is a burnt baby and there is an abducted baby and there is an orphaned baby and there is a day-old baby still linked to his mother's body by an umbilical cord. He hadn't even managed to find out his name. What will be inscribed on the tiny headstone with a single date for birth and death? Let us go slowly again and pay attention to what is lost in translation. I'd like to start that by listening to the first line. Obviously, you all recognize the words of the Kaddish. We didn't translate them. Yitkadal v'yitkadash meirabha. Now, and no one came, okay, it's a statement. But it's much stronger in the original Hebrew because of the rhyming. Listen to it again in Hebrew. Yitgadal v'yitkadash meirabha ve'af echad lo ba. It's sort of really yelling at him. You are Rabba, you are the greatest. Where were you? And then the cynical, many thousands called him, crying his name, begging him. Look at all the levels of prayer, calling, crying, begging. But he sees from all his work, right? So that's the problem with you, God. You don't work on Shabbat. We should have asked the Hamas to do it on Monday or what? Can you hear the bitterness of the criticism? Is that it? You are not there on Shabbat for us. Thank you. And now look at the no one, no God, no God. And there is a very big stress on that because he is the one, right? Adonai Echad, and there was no one, no one, no one came, no one called. And when God is not present, This is what happens. In the absence of God, it becomes the realm of Satan. Only Satan celebrated uninterrupted dancing between kibbutzim and the slaughter festival, a pun on the Hebrew name of such festivals, Festival Teva, festival in nature, turned into Mesibat Tevach, slaughter. Again, just one letter is changed. And when God is not, then there yesh, the is, burned baby, abducted baby, orphaned baby, one day old baby. You can see the juxtaposition of the absence to the presence. God is not there, burned baby, abducted baby, deceased baby, one day old baby. The two cannot coexist. Had God been there, there wouldn't be the realm of Satan. Since God chose to be absent, this is what we get. Notice in the middle, between the two, as our correspondent goes on to report, all a while sobbing. This is where Asaf is telling us about himself. He is a journalist. He is a correspondent on the radio, and he is sharing us with us what he had experienced. And the ending of the poem, again, look at the graphics. Even if you cannot read Hebrew, you might recognize the font, the letters Shiva, which means seven, big, broken heart underneath, small letters October. But the word Shiva, which is seven, is also Shiva, morning. And this connects to another thing that is happening in Israel nowadays. As we are counting the days of the war, it's 109th today. We keep saying the date today is October 109th. We are all in a time capsule. So let's conclude it with the poem. כך נראה הקיבוץ אחרי ביקור הסוטן. מחזיר את השידור לאולפן. עכשיו שקט יורים, יש גם שיגורים ואין ממשלה ואין רחמים, רק הצרחות והתמונות לא יצאו לעולם מהראש השביעי באוקטובר 2023. This is what the kibbutz looks like after Satan's visit, שבעה באוקטובר, like a Shiva. Turning the broadcast back into the studio, he is reassuming his role as a reporter. Quiet now, they are shooting. They are also launching rockets, and there is no government, and there is no mercy, just the screaming and the pictures that will never leave the mind. The 7th of October, 2023. And the Hebrew, of course, has the rhyme here, which the English cannot have, because if you want a good translation, oftentimes what needs to be given up is the rhyme. So just listen to the Hebrew. ורק הצרחות והתמונות לא יצאו לעולם מהראש השביעי באוקטובר 2023. The shalosh of the three is rhyming with the rosh of the mind of the head. And we have moved from the description of a mutilated language into the phase that oftentimes is apparent in literature of tragedy, both the Holocaust, both the Kishinev pogrom, etc., and that is loss of face. Bevakasha, Vicky, please unmute.
Yeah, hi. It's strange to me that he used Hashvi'i be'oktober, because it's not the correct way of saying. The correct way is Shiv'a be'oktober.
I'm glad that you know what's the correct way.
Yeah,
that's very nice.
We say Asara be'tevet, Tish'a be'av, Shiv'a be'elul, or Shiv'a be'oktober. And here it could fit, never mind that it's not correct, Hebrew, but if you have used the word Shiv'a, October, that would fit even better with the theme of Shiva.
Okay, I can give you his email and you can write to him and correct him as teachers would. And I will accept the license of poets to create the rhythm and the tone that they want.
Right, absolutely.
So it's good for you to know what's correct and what's not, and I will still accept the license of the poet to write his way. But I can ask him about that. We have become friends in all the correspondence. And he continues.
It's a very, very powerful piece of poetry. Very powerful.
I think so. And it's very much, if you know a history of a Hebrew Jewish poetry after major disasters, it's totally in conversation with Bialik's Al HaShechita, right? Which I cannot go into, but he is in a solid tradition of claiming justice from God after a major tragedy. Okay, so he knows his poetry, he knows his language, and thank you for your comment, Vicky. Anybody else? Okay, so let me continue, and this time I will want to adopt a different method of teaching, and I hope you will follow and come with me in this venture. So what we are going to do now is the following. Be'eri by Adi Blechman Sofer, with the translation of Adi together with the team, because she asked for a few corrections. And I will read it. I will make no comment at all whatsoever. And then I will lead you, sort of holding your hand, by teaching you three important notions that are connected to this poem. And then I'd like to hope and to assume that when we read the poem again after this voyage, you will have it full in your hands without me needing to do drash over it. Okay, so let's try. Be'eri. עוד מעט יגיע החורף, עננים בוכים ישקו את האדמה, ויצמיחו מרבדים אדומים, תחילה תפרח הכלנית ואף אחד לא יבוא לצפות ביופיה. אחריה תפרח הנורית ולא יתקיים פסטיבל. ולבסוף יפרח הפרג ושקט אין איש. הפרחים המוגנים נקטפו כבר בסתיו. בערי בידי בלחמן סופר. Soon winter will be here. Weeping clouds will water the earth, making red carpets grow. The anemone will flower first, yet no one will come to admire its beauty. The buttercup will bloom next, and there will be no festival. The poppy will flower last in silence, seen by none. The protected flowers had already been picked in the fall. Bear with me, we are going on a journey. Stop number one. A very famous poem written during World War I by no else by a Canadian poet, John McCrae, who was a soldier, if I remember correctly, a physician among the Canadian troops fighting in World War I in Flanders in Belgium. In Flanders fields, the poppies blow between the crosses row on row that mark our place, and in the sky the lark still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago we lived, fell dawn, so sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high. If you break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep though poppies grow in Flanders fields. So by now, over 100 years old poem, it's a classic. From it comes the custom, the minhag, to wear a sticker with poppies on Memorial Day for fallen soldiers. It is often quoted, actually, one of those poems that speak to us in the name of the fallen. They speak to us, they tell us of their experience, they tell us what they expect the coming soldiers after them to do and how to remember. And from it, the image of poppy fields, all, you know, to the end of the horizon, are symbols of fallen soldiers in most of the Western cultures. Keep hold that knowledge in your mind. Second stop. In Israel, there is a notion of protected wild flowers. If you were as old as myself, you will remember that as a child, one of the things we loved to do most, I'm talking about the 50s, when I'm growing up, I was born in 46, is to go out into nature, to the hills near our home or the orchards or whatever in the season, which is right now, after Hanukkah, before Tu Bishvat, all the way to Purim, to pick wild flowers, the anemones, kalaniyot, and the cyclamen, rakafot, and the narcissus, narcissim, and tzivonim, the wild tulips, and so on and so forth. And we were so enthusiastic about it that we managed to destroy our wild flowers, so much so that Israeli government came out with legislation that declared a number of flowers protected and one is not allowed to pick them. Let me step out for a minute and share with you something. Of all the major educational endeavors of Israeli authorities to teach us Israelis to behave, this is the only successful one. We continue to push other people in line. We throw butts of cigarettes on the beach. We oftentimes cough and spit and whatever, but flowers we do not touch. From early age in schools, kids are taught, and I used to have a friend who was a botanist, actually a professor, and he had a special permit in his pocket because he would need to pick certain flowers for his research, and kids would yell at him. I could tell you that in the 90s, when the major Aliyah wave of immigration from the former Soviet Union started arriving, I was working for the Jewish Agency Department of Education, and we created the curriculum for the Hebrew classes that were taught both there and upon arrival in Israel. And we included lessons about the protected flowers. God forbid they should do what they do in Russia, go out into the fields and pick flowers and people will yell at them. So this is a very strong notion. We have songs about the need to protect the flowers. We have legislation, we have classes. We love our wild flowers and we don't pick them. We don't destroy them. And now the third and last for this particular lesson. So the fields of flowers, the protected flowers. There is this notion called Darom Adom, Red South. In the area of Israel that you now know from the news as the Otef, namely the Western Negev, the envelope around Gaza Strip, where Be'eri is the largest kibbutz, comes this time of the year, you have fields and fields of anemones. And everybody loves them so much that we have Chag HaKalaniyot B'Tzfon HaNegev, the festival of anemones in the northern Negev. And this is what the fields look like. This is an honest-to-go picture that was taken a year or two ago. So we love going to that part of the country. We love enjoying the red color of the anemones. So hold all that in your soul and mind, and let me read to you the poem again. We will do only the English now. Soon winter will be here. Weeping clouds will water the earth, making red carpets grow. The anemone will flower first, yet no one will come to admire its beauty. The buttercup will bloom next, and there will be no festival. The poppy will flower last in silence, seen by none. The protected flowers had already been picked in the fall. So just look at these three notions. You will have the poppy will flower last in silence, you have the mentioning of the festival, and you have the notion of the protected flowers that were all picked before their time to bloom had come. And obviously you can see that the red flowers are metaphors for the lost life in those fields. As I told you, graphic artists responded in very similar way to the one of the poets by illustrating the same notion. So here is by Michelle Kishka, one of the works of art that were created in response to this poem, in response to the tragedy that happened in these very parts. Let me just check with you if there are any comments or questions so far. Yes, Bivakasha Carol, please go ahead. Please unmute yourself. Yes.
I just want to know why it is permitted to sell hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of anemones on Thursdays and Fridays before Shabbat.
Those are artificially grown in hothouses, not the natural ones. Nobody touches the ones in nature. These are artificially grown in hothouses. Yeah, thank you for your question.
They're still beautiful.
I know that, but if you go out into the fields, you will see them in... actually, we did go out, Yossi and I, last week because, you know, not big festivals, but we wanted... for just for the two of us to be able to sit in one of those fields in quiet for a bit. Anybody else? Okay. I think for, yes, please, Connie.
So I'm not sure it's about this poem, but we're talking about the symbolism of poetry. And so I was so struck in the poem we called For God, which is, I mean, you know, Elie Wiesel, people, it's something that recurs so much in our literature. We called for God, God wasn't there. But we all have, we're made in the B'Tselem Hashem, right? So we're made in God's image. And people did call. They weren't calling for God. They were calling for man.
Ah, thank you. This is a good introduction for the next poem.
Okay.
Thank you so much. I was debating whether to do it or not, but yes, I will do it now since you asked. So this poem also requires a bit of an introduction. And
lost you.
Hang on for a minute, because since I lost the internet for a minute, I need to refix something, and then we can continue. Okay. So you are all back, I am back, and we are going back to the poem that will address exactly what I want to. So when you raise children in Israel, generations and generation, my mother to me to my children to their children, I have now a grandson in the military, and we keep telling them, my child, when you grow up, there will be no more wars, so that you can live with love. Mothers will never worry again. These are just quotes from pieces of literature. Then I took a deep breath, smiled, and told him he had nothing to worry about. He had nothing to worry about because when he grows up, there will be no more wars. When we were born, the elders blessed us with teary eyes. They said, these kids, God willing, will not go to the army. This is what I call the classic multi-generational Israeli lie. we keep educating our children that we are working towards a different future, and by the time their turn comes, forget it. Our next poem is based on that. So let me take you there. And here we go. So it's by Itai Lev. I am adding the graphic art of Yossi Lemel that created a heart in the shape of a sabra of the cactus fruit with all those red flowers in it, metaphors for lost life. And we will start with the Ivrit. Ima tamid sodeket, by Itai Lev. אמא אמרה שעד שאגדל כבר לא יהיה צבא. אמא צדקה. עוד לא גדלתי וכבר לא היה צבא. הוא לא היה כששמעתי צעקות בחוץ. הוא לא היה כשראיתי את אבא כל כך מפוחד ולחוץ. הוא לא היה כשדלת הבית נפרצה בביתה. הוא לא היה כשהתחבאתי מתחת למיטה. הוא לא היה כשהדפנו שלושתנו את דלת הממד. הוא לא היה כשהזמן פשוט עמד. הוא לא היה כשהם נכנסו פתאום פנימה. הוא לא היה כשהם קראו את אבא מאמא. אמא אמרה שעד שאגדל כבר לא יהיה צבא, אמא צדקה. ועכשיו רק רציתי להגיד לה שהיא תמיד צודקת. בכיתי, צעקתי, והיא עדיין שותקת. Mom is always right, by Itai Lev. Mom said that when I grew up, there would be no army. Mom was right. I haven't yet grown up, and already there was no army. It wasn't there when I heard the screaming outside. It wasn't there when I saw Dad so scared and stressed. It wasn't there when the door was kicked in. It wasn't there when I hid under the bed. It wasn't there when we three pushed back on the door of the safe room. It wasn't there when the time just stood still. It wasn't there when they suddenly entered. It wasn't there when they tore Dad off Mom. Mom had said that when I grew up, there would be no army. Mom was right. Now all I want is to tell her that she is always right. I cried. I screamed, and still she is silent. It's not only God that we blame. I wanted you to have samplings of each tendency. I'd like to conclude, to take 5, maximum 7 more minutes of your time for something very special, and special for Montreal. So I trust all of you, being who you are and living in Montreal, have heard about Leonard Cohen, right? You don't need me to tell you about him. Here is the text of his famous poem, Who by Fire, inspired by the Yom Kippur prayers. And also Shana Mi Ba'esh. During this war, a lyric writer in the Otef, in that part of the world that envelops the Gaza Strip, had written, taken on Who by Fire, and wrote, with all the names of all the kibbutzim, moshavim, and towns in that area that were hit and breached into, and people murdered and burned and raped, etc. And he created his own version, Who in Be'eri, all the names of the places. Who in Be'eri, who in Kfar Aza, who in Kisufim, who in Kibbutz Sufa, who in Ofakim, who is dancing near Re'im, who in Netiv Ha'asara, who at the division headquarters, and who will have mercy on us, who in Sderot and who in the police station, who in Nachal Oz and who in Nir Oz besieged, who in Niram, who in Moshav Prigan, who in the Zikim area, who at Mefalsim Junction, and who will protect us, shield us, who at the Black Arrow Monument, who with the Alert Squad a hero, who in Erez, who in Ein HaShlosha, who in Nir Yitzchak, who squeezed in a shelter, who in Alumim, in Nirim, in Mivtachim, and who will call our name. Let me just take you there. Bear with me for a moment as we are listening. Bevakasha. Can you see and hear, all of you? Rabbi, please tell me. Please unmute and let me know if you could hear.
Yes, I can see and I can hear.
This concludes our session. I think in a way that's appropriate for this particular congregation. Let me say a word to you before we say goodbye. I have a website that you can explore with already 11 such sessions of this poetry. The website is just my last name, korazim.com. And then go to recorded lectures and everything that says poems of our day for our days 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., all the way to 11, we'll have that. If you want to join live classes and you are not yet on my mailing list, you have also to remember a very complicated email address, korazim@gmail.com. Again, just use my last name, tell me that you want to register, and I will put you on the mailing list. Classes will resume on February 15th. And should the Shah want one more session or more, that also is a possibility. And now I'm not in a rush. If there are any more comments or questions, I would welcome to entertain them and respond as best I can.
I don't know, is this working?
Yes, of course it's working.
Well, I'm glad I didn't couldn't tell with my skills.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. I attended a course with you at Pardes, and it was so good that when I saw that the Shah was sponsoring this, I got involved because I don't live in Toronto, in Montreal anymore. I live in Toronto, but I'm still a member of the Shah. Mm-hmm. One, besides being a wonderful presentation, you did one thing which I truly appreciate. I've been talking to my friend in Israel, and I've never understood a lot of the things she was feeling and saying. Now I understand. and I feel more that I'm one with her, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you. This is exactly what I'm hoping to do, to offer you ways to connect that are beyond the TV screens and beyond donations that are appreciated and worrying that we understand. But reading, I think, this poetry is helpful in that way. And I'm glad you said it, Joel. Thank you.
It was my extreme pleasure. I take it as being recorded. Will we be able to get it?
Yes, I will send. I will send the link to both rabbis as soon as I get it. It's normally 20 minutes after the session. Roma, you had your hand up. Please unmute. You don't want to. Okay. Anybody else? Yes, Vicky. Please unmute.
I have a question about the last piece of poetry that turned into a song. That it's unclear to me the end. Umi yikra bishmenu. I'm not sure I got it. I have a feeling that it's referred to some source. I mean, maybe you can help me on that.
Yeah, it refers to Leonard Cohen's Who by Fire.
And then he refers to Umi yikra bishmenu there in
Who will call our name? Leonard Cohen, Who by Fire. He just in conversation with that, this is we do oftentimes in Israeli songs that people will create new lyrics to old songs. We do that quite often. So this is taking not an Israeli song, but a Jewish song, Who by Fire, and creating the contemporary lyrics. It's a thing that one does with Israeli songs oftentimes. Toby, your turn, and Marina after that.
Thank you. Very, very much. I was very touched by all these poems by the new young poets in Israel. Very touched, and I thank you.
Thank you. Marina, please unmute.
Thank you very much. When you first sent the handout, I was really sad and heartbroken. I can't express how I feel, and it really... Your class really puts the mood into what Israel is about in ways we don't know. But my question is, I was 8 years old or thereabout when the Yom Kippur War happened. And I vividly remember my grade 5 teacher just stunned in front of me and playing HaMilchama Achrona, the Tachlit, over and over again. And every Friday for the whole year. I obviously know this situation is different. So my first question is, two questions. How early did people say Mashlom Shulmech or Mashlomcha after the Yom Kippur War? And when do you think that word will be reintegrated, or what's the new word to say that you're there for somebody or thinking of them now in Israel?
Marina, you are actually asking me, when will this be over?
I'm asking, I just wanted to ask, when it happened in Yom Kippur War, were people not saying Mashlomech or Mashlomcha for a very long time?
I don't remember. It was 50 years ago. I had two babies, a 3-year-old, a 2-year-old, husband on reserve duty. I don't remember.
Okay, so then my question is, what phrase do we say for people we care about in Israel? Or what is the phrase that you say with each other outside of what was said in the poem? Like, it's Mashlomech, not Mashlomcha.
We actually do say, Makore is used. Echata, Echat, we say. One of the big things that changed, and for which I can give you is for a formula, is the ending of conversations. And in emails, in speaking, it's the same. Besorot tovot, good tidings. We wish each other good tidings. Besorot tovot. That's like the etiquette of the day. Right, Maxine? This is what everybody says at the end of a verbal conversation, at the end of a lecture, at the end of a phone conversation with the taxi driver, Besorot Tovot, and in emails. I sign all my emails nowadays, Besorot Tovot. So yes, a language is developing, the hope for good tidings, the hope for something good to happen.
Thank you.
Okay, I hope this is helpful. I don't remember the Mashlocha in 73.
Oh, it's very helpful, and also to be sensitive to our language. And I just wanted to say the map of that went with the Who By Fire song, It just really hit. I'm surprised it's not on the news or whatever, but just to see the expanse of how far it was, it just really hits home. I'm surprised it's not publicized more. But that really struck.
Okay, thank you, Marina. Gloria, please just don't forget to unmute. Yeah,
I won't forget. Rachel, I just wanted to tell you, you are definitely my role model for so many freedoms to express oneself. Not that I need that, I'm very good at expressing myself. However, I want to say that in Israel, my impression is it's like a collective Shiva. And everybody, you know, the empathy is palpable. You have no choice. It's one huge family. Even if you have different political leanings, it's one huge family. And just, I want to give kudos to you, because I think besides witnessing, sitting, holding a virtual hand of somebody who is in sitting Shiva, you are also actively at every single demonstration for bring the hostages home. And I think it's important that we have both, that we don't just sit wringing our hands mourning, that you also have to be proactive to say, okay, we're still living and we still need to do something.
As much as I can, and lots of other volunteering and fundraising, etc. Also in my neighborhood, between Jews and Arabs, I live in Yafo, a mixed population, and there are volunteers, Jews and Arabs, working, talking to each other, making sure that if there is tension anywhere, it should be taken care of. Yes, a lot of doing. And thank you, Gloria, for mentioning that. Yeah, if you were my Facebook friends, you could see every Saturday night the pictures of the demonstrations, because I go every single week. And sometimes I go earlier, and we do Havdalah with the families, and sometimes I do something else, but I'm very, very present, in the present as much as I can. And thank you for that. Yeah, anybody else? Yes, please, Vicky, please unmute.
I have a question. You mentioned about shiurim with you, and I'm not sure if you're in North America or in Israel. Are the shiurim in person, on Zoom? Because
I live in the southern part of Tel Aviv. It's 8:15 p.m. by me now. And you can see the window behind me. It's all dark. Okay. All right.
So the shiurim are on Zoom?
All the classes are on Zoom. And if you go to my website, at the bottom, there is a place to register. On Thursdays, 7 p.m. Israel time, which is noon time in Montreal, we have a class in Ivrit. We don't study poetry of our days. We study something else, because the class in Hebrew opted for something else. They said they had enough of the situation. And 9 p.m., which is 2 p.m. your time, we have the class in English. This is a class very well attended. There is at least 100 participants every week, many times more. And we bring the poets and we discuss poetry of these days. And Gloria had been at quite a few, and she could say a word about that maybe. Okay. So, toda rabba, chavarim. Thank you for being here. Laila tov to all the Israelis, to Maxine, to Rabbi Fishman. And I will let you conclude the session, Rabbi.
Rachel, thank you so much. I don't want to try to encapsulate or summarize what this session was. I'm still processing it. It was very emotional for me, actually. I just want to end with words of thanks. I think there are very few people who can touch on these really deep undercurrents of emotion, and you are certainly one of them. So for doing so, and for taking us along on this journey with you tonight, or this afternoon if you're in Montreal, I am so grateful. We are so grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Mark, I will send you the link as soon as I get it. Okay.
For everybody that was watching, it usually takes us one day, and then all of the recorded videos are on the Shah HaShemayim's YouTube channel. So if you go to YouTube and type in Shah HaShemayim, you will find the recording usually 24 hours later. So you can rewatch this or share the link with your friends and continue Rachel's poetry. And
not Rachel. If you call me Rachel, Rachel. I'll never come back.
Rachel.
You can extend Rachel's poetry even further. So, very much.
Bye-bye.
Litraot.